And I begin to think that this could be a very fundamental hint to what is going on in the whole universe.
Explain.
Well, there's the cosmologists, there's a holy grail of the cosmologists, which is what they call the it used to be called the Copernican principle, but it's now called the cosmological principle, which is that if you look at a large enough region of the universe, it will look like any other equally large region anywhere else in the universe. It looks the same anywhere you are. So that's called the cosmological principle. They're very pleased that they think they've got that in cosmology, thanks to the theory of inflation in there. But I'm wondering if it doesn't really actually go back to Newton's idea, and that you don't need inflation at all. Because if you imagine you put a dime, a small coin, anywhere down on that section on the right, shall we say that's a tenth of the diameter of the total thing on the right, it would cover shapes that look much the same. It would satisfy the cosmological principle.
Uh-huh.
And if you had spheres containing the particles, small spheres containing the particles in the one on the left, they would also look the same wherever you put the sphere, unless it was right at the edge and you were at the rim. So that's pretty interesting. That comes straight out of Newton's theory, and this quantity that we call the complexity. The specialists in the field call it the shape complexity or the normalized Newton constant, and it is actually the quantity that really governs everything of interest that happens in the Newtonian n-body problem. It's the Newton potential is not really what counts. It's that this quantity, what I call the complexity, and what the n-body people call the shape potential. What is very interesting, very, very few people except the specialists in the field know about this thing. You can have these total collisions. They were first discovered in 1907 by a Finnish mathematician called Carl Sundman. And he was the first person to ask, in Newton's theory, is it possible for three particles to collide all at once at their center of mass? And he proved that they could. Very remarkable, very sophisticated mathematics. Subject to some very interesting conditions. First, the angular momentum must be zero. There must be no overall rotation in the system. Sure. And secondly, as it comes to the total collision, the shape must become very special. Either it must become an equilateral triangle, whatever the mass is, or it must become a collinear configuration where one particle is there are three of those because one particle can be in between the others, and that's whatever the mass is. So that's very, very interesting. And then a year later, somebody called Bloch showed that Sundman's result is exactly the same thing happens, more or less exactly the same thing happens, if there are any number of particles. This is 1907, 1908. Now, Newton's equations work both way in time. So instead of thinking of it as a total collision, you can suppose it's going the other way. And then it becomes a Newtonian Big Bang. Extraordinarily uniform. And this is 20 years before Hubble publishes the law for the expansion of the universe. So if that isn't thought-provoking, I don't know what is. And very, very few people working in cosmology know about these facts.
So are you saying that there's this formula here called complexity, which different people in different fields call it different names, like shape potential, you said, the n-body people call it.
Yep.
If you minimize this, it's like minimizing the action, their version of the action. If you minimize this, that is the state of the universe at any given point or any given slice of time or instant I'm not sure what to say there.
It characterizes the shape of, if you accept my idea that there are Newtonian Big Bangs, so the Newtonian Big Bangs start from these very special shapes, and in particular, they can start from the one which is most uniform, that alpha. So it would be very like the one on the left, that ball on the left. So that would be the first instant of time, the first instant of a Newtonian Big Bang.
So looking at this image with the circles, and one is more dense on the left, one is more sparse on the right, you're saying
the one on the right is the section through, the equatorial section through. The one on the left is if you were to speak, if it was a swarm of bees, what it would look like if it was a swarm of bees.
So what we're actually looking at on the left one is the 3D version of just points.
That's right, yes. It's a 3D version of, I think it's 5,000 particles, but it might be 500. But you see how amazingly smooth it is.
Why is it odd that it's smooth? So you're saying that uniform. It's not that you started out with a sphere and you're just trying to populate it with some uniform probability over the points inside the sphere. You started out with something else and it became a sphere?
Let's go back, because I think the story is worth telling. It all goes back to Leibniz and me being so impressed by it. So Leibniz said, I think variety is the most important thing in the universe. So I tried to find an expression which characterizes that variety. And I found it, lo and behold, in Isaac Newton's theory of gravity. And then I later on discovered, well, I did know it more or less at the same time. No, a little bit later, I discovered that actually there are Newtonian Big Bangs, that the Newtonian Big Bangs start, the most interesting Newtonian Big Bangs, but they all start when that takes a very special shape, and the most interesting ones start when it's at its most uniform shape. So you're led more or less directly to a Newtonian Big Bangs, and they start maximally uniform, but as they progress, as time passes in the way we think of it, structures form, and the universe gets more structured, more ordered. And so that is the exact opposite of the second law of thermodynamics, which says that the universe goes from being ordered to being uniform and uninteresting. And we've got exactly the opposite behavior coming out of Newton. So this is quite a bit of what my book, The Janus Point, is about. We are challenging it's a belief which is now held for 170 years, that the only way to explain our sense of the direction of time, the arrow of time, is that entropy is increasing, that disorder is increasing. But we're finding strong evidence in Newton's theory that it's the exact opposite. Now, it's a different matter. Within those Newtonian universes, subsystems can form, clusters can form as they get ever more structured. Subsystems can form within them, and as they form and then decay, they do behave like thermodynamic systems. They do what's called virialize, which is characteristic of thermodynamic systems. So in some senses, we're deriving the second law of thermodynamics and saying that it's not as fundamental. Let me read you what the famous English astronomer Arthur Eddington said. The law that entropy always increases holds, I think, the supreme position among the laws of nature. If your theory is found to be against the second law of thermodynamics, I can give you no hope. There is nothing for it to collapse in deepest humiliation.
Right.
And let me now add something that Einstein said on thermodynamics. He said, it is the only physical theory of universal content which I am convinced that within the framework of applicability of its basic concepts will never be overthrown. Now, the interesting thing is Einstein did not say, what is the framework of applicability of its basic concepts? And I think this is a point that I'm making throughout the Janus point. I think people have just completely forgotten what are the conditions under which thermodynamics is valid. And that goes back to how thermodynamics was discovered. It came out of Sadi Carnot in 1824, wrote this wonderful little book on the motive power of fire, in which he was working out conditions under which steam engines operate with maximal efficiency. And that was what led 25, 26 years later to the discovery of the first two laws of thermodynamics. Now, a steam engine stops working if the steam escapes from the cylinder. The steam has to be in a box. And if you look at the wonderful definition of entropy by Rudolf Clausius, it's all about a system in a box where the size of the box is slowly changed and you control whether heat is getting in and out. It's absolutely critical the box is there. And then if you look at the atomistic explanation of the laws of thermodynamics, starting also with Clausius, but then Maxwell, then Boltzmann, and then Gibbs, they all assume molecules in a box. They bump into each other and they bounce off the walls of the box elastically. And nobody, and I'll now stick my neck out, I don't think anybody has seriously asked, what happens if the box is not there? This is what the main message of the Janus point is. Things are just completely different. It's as different as night and day. And amazingly, people haven't thought about that.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.